Sutton. This is Road to Recovery. And today, my special guests are Anna Mabel Jones and Mark Spence. Welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So both of you work with Oxford House, and specifically, you're like pretty high up on the food chain.
Thank you.
So can you tell us a little bit about yourself, Anna?
Sure. Thanks for having us. I'm a woman in long-term recovery, which for me means that I haven't used a drink or a drug and going on 20 years.
Wow, congratulations.
Yeah, thank you. And I truly feel that Oxford House is part of that. I moved into an Oxford House in 1999 with 6 months clean and haven't picked up, felt the need to pick up a drug or a drink since.
Fantastic.
Those women in there were pretty stern and they were serious about their recovery. There was an interview process, so I really felt like I had to be prepared to come in and start the journey of recovery. You have to be accepted and voted on in an Oxford House. So that was sort of unique to me, being a person who relapse is a part of my story.
Okay.
So being in there and being able to take responsibility, and the houses are independently ran, so that was the beginning for me to not have anyone telling me what to do and being able to have a key to come and go, but being around like-minded women in recovery. So it's more of a peer-to-peer process.
Okay.
So that's a little bit about me of where I started my road to recovery. It was truly in an Oxford House. And today I'm honored to be here as the Oxford House Resource Coordinator.
Okay.
So I get to give back what was given to me and get paid for it.
Hey, fantastic.
So that's pretty awesome.
That's the best of both worlds when you can get paid for doing something that you enjoy.
Yeah.
Well, they say get paid for something you would have done for free, right?
That's
yeah,
right.
Exactly.
So let me ask Mark to identify himself. So Mark, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Okay, well, Mark Spence, I'm born and raised in Washington, D.C. Had a lot of problems. I grew up a Catholic boy, and I went to Catholic grade school, Catholic high school, and with a scholarship for basketball to Wheeling Jesuit College in Wheeling, West Virginia.
Okay.
Never used drugs and alcohol until I went to college.
Wow.
Never really even kissed a girl until I went to college, and I got exposed to all this stuff. All the negativity.
Yeah, you're a basketball star.
Yeah, back in the day. And so I got introduced to the marijuana, to the alcohol first, and then it became a way of life for me. You know, I just had to use every day. And when I came home, after I graduated in 1983, by the way, I was the 13th African-American to ever graduate from Wheeling Jesuit College.
Wow.
Yeah, the 16th in the school's history.
Wow.
Yeah, to graduate.
So you're part of history.
Yeah. So great. I was excited about that and came home and gravitated to everything that was negative, you know what I mean, with this degree, and ended up in an alley in Washington, D.C. and wanted to kill myself. And, you know, and I just said, man, God, please help me. And I went to treatment, Seton House, the next day.
Oh, yeah, Seton House.
Yeah, I went to Seton House for a couple of weeks, and I got educated to what was going on with me. I had the disease of addiction, and it could however be arrested by going to these meetings and getting the sponsor and all that type of stuff. And while I was in there, they introduced me to Oxford House. The Oxford House representative came in and talked about Oxford House, and then I went over and got accepted. And I just need to say this, I've never used again. I've just celebrated 30 years
of recovery. Fantastic.
Yeah, so, great. Yeah.
Predecessor.
Yes.
So let me go back to Anna. So Anna, for the viewers that don't know what Oxford House is, can you kind of give an idea of what is an Oxford House?
Sure, love to. Oxford Houses are self-ran, independent houses for people who are recovering from alcohol or drug addiction. Oxford Houses have been around since 1975. The first Oxford House was actually in Silver Spring, Maryland.
All right, Montgomery County.
First Oxford House.
Right, yeah.
Yes. Of course, it expanded because who better to know your behavior than someone who's been through it?
Right.
They're peer-to-peer ran. They're positions, you're voted into officers' positions. Each house has 6 officers' positions. And there normally we follow the manual, which is the Oxford House manual.
That's a national manual?
It's a national manual.
Okay.
We really have 2,500 houses. We've expanded since 1975 to, starting in Montgomery County to now being in 43 states.
Okay.
Of course, we're also in Africa.
Oh, wow.
Australia.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. Canada.
Great.
we're excited about that. And constantly expanding to meet the need. We're evidence-based, so they have been several books written about Oxford House through DePaul University.
Okay.
So there's a lot of data about the importance of recovery housing and living in Oxford House and how, you know, you have a success rate. Our success rate is 87%.
Oh, okay. So a person that leaves treatment and moves into an Oxford House
has an 87% chance of staying clean for the rest of their life.
That's good. That's a pretty good number.
Yeah,
that's
great
so
number.
Attractive yeah. to yeah. me on that note. We're expanding. Basically, again, I said they're self-ran. They're independent, independently run. Everything is voted on from a can opener. There are weekly house meetings. Most of the members go to meetings on a daily basis
okay.
To help them sustain their recovery.
Mm-hmm.
It's just really the best thing out there when it comes to recovery housing and helping people grow in their recovery.
But sober houses are run by the owner, by the proprietor, and the
yep.
rules can vary. I've heard some nightmares like you got to pay $20 if you leave a dirty dish in the sink, and all kinds of horror stories
yeah.
about some sober houses yeah. that are just houses that a person purchased and they're renting it to someone who's mm-hmm. in recovery.
Right.
And sometimes they can be taken advantage of because they're very vulnerable.
Right.
Yeah.
Going from active addiction mm-hmm. to entering and trying to integrate back into society, try to get a job, try not to use drugs and alcohol, mm-hmm. reconnect with their family. So if you have a structure that's already in place that's worked for so many people, right. that's very inviting.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
And now how is it across the country? Is Montgomery County any different from other places,
well,
Mark?
Well, it's the same everywhere. I often say it's sort of like the Big Mac. The Big Mac is made up the same way. Two offbeat patties, special sauce, lettuce, cheese, pickles, onions on a sesame seed bun.
Everywhere
you go in the world, Oxford houses are run the same exact way. We have zero tolerance for drinking and drugging. It's run on a democratic basis, and it has to be fully financially self-supporting. So basically what we do, we rent a nice house in a nice neighborhood, put folks that are in recovery into the house, to the home, and teach them how to run the house amongst one another, where they're accountable to one another, they police one another, they're supportive of one another, and we've been able to grow from that. You know, how we started was that our founder, Paul Malloy, stayed in a state-run halfway house in Silver Spring. There was 13 men in there, and the house was about to close down. So they went complaining and crying at the time to the AA meeting, like, oh, man, we doing good, and the state taking it away from us.
Right.
And one of the, you know, predecessors in there was like, well, see if they own a house or rent a house. So they said, okay, they rent the house. Well, who's going to cook for us? Who's going to clean for us? And all that kind of stuff. And the guy said, you rent it, and you guys set up rules. And that's what they did. They set up rules, and today, like Anna said, we're all over the world now, 6 different countries actually, you know, 45 states.
Wow.
Close to, you know, well over 2,600 houses now.
Yeah.
Yep.
And it's nonprofit.
Nonprofit.
Yes.
Can yep. businesses contribute, or how does that work?
Yes.
As a resource coordinator, I'm always looking for donations. So we definitely, as a 501c, we're always looking for that. We're always looking for people who are willing to rent their houses in nice neighborhoods.
Okay.
Because that is the best way for someone to recover, not going back to the same area that they lived in.
Yeah, right. People, places, and things.
Yeah, people,
yeah,
places,
right.
and things is major. I know it was for me. Of course, I shared I was from Washington, D.C., so it was like I needed to get away. I couldn't go back to that same neighborhood.
Yeah.
And Oxford House had that for me.
Right.
So in looking for any furniture donations, you know, things of that nature that'll help the houses, because we've had houses that have been around. There's no time limit, which is a major thing for people to know when you live in an Oxford House.
Oh,
so it
okay.
helps where some of the best tenants possible, so landlords rent to us for years. So our website, which is www.oxfordhouse.org, you can look on there and you'll see at the bottom of the house is a picture, but it'll also show you how long that house has been established. So we're always looking for donations of furniture, paintings, anything like that.
Yeah, I really
yeah.
like your website, because when I go on your website, mm-hmm. it shows the picture of the house. It shows the vacancies,
mm-hmm.
and, you know, that is so good, Ben, because I used to just look at the vacancies and see the number of people that can move in, but actually you can see the picture.
Yeah.
So that's mm-hmm. great. Then, oh, yeah. then you can kind of see if that meets your taste. Yeah. Now, when you said there's no time, you mean there's no amount of clean time to move in, or you can live there as long as you like?
Oh, that's a wonderful question. Depending on the interview on the clean time, but there you can live there as long as you like is what I meant. So we feel that everybody's process is different right. when you're coming into recovery. So we're not like, oh, you have to do this. We're not putting you in the box. You have no time limit as long as you follow the Oxford House Charter.
Okay.
Yeah, so every house is chartered through our World Service Office, which again is in Silver Spring, Maryland.
Oh, is it? Okay.
Yeah, and they are the organization that charters the charters each house.
I see.
Mm-hmm. Well, when it started.
Yes.
So, and I remember you guys have a world convention too, like the NA and AA convention.
Yeah, we have a world convention that started up about, I guess, like over 20 years ago.
Oh, yes.
They started the world convention. The first one was in D.C. And so what we do is we rotate every other year in Washington, D.C., and then we pick a state around the country that we have a whole lot of houses.
Right.
We've got a lot of support. So we just recently came back from Kansas City, Missouri.
Yes.
Which was absolutely incredible. We got the best ribs you ever want
to
have.
Oh, my goodness, they were delicious.
You should have brought me some.
Yeah, but we probably had about 1,900 people that was there.
Okay.
Yeah, so our next one is in Washington, D.C. this year coming up, Labor Day weekend.
Oh, I'm going to try to make that.
Yeah.
Oh, that would be awesome, James.
Yeah.
We would love
right
to have you.
Yeah.
And we're expecting even more people, so we're excited because they're going to be coming to our area.
Right.
And we're going to be hosting
it. So you're the host, right?
Yes. Yeah, we're the host, so it's a lot of planning happening with chapters in our area.
Yeah. Oh, okay,
so we
great.
Have those two.
Fantastic. Now, we're going to take a break in a minute, but I wanted you to talk about special populations. For instance, I always have a hard time finding housing for women with children. Mm-hmm. Women, you know, it seems like there's a lot of Oxford houses for men, mm-hmm. but what about the women in recovery, and what about the women who have children? And I've never heard about an Oxford House with men and children.
We also have those too.
Is that right?
They're not. In certain states, we do have men with children because just like women, they need it.
We actually can create with the need. So if we get abundance of men with a child, want to take care of their child, then we can actually start an Oxford House for them. So you know, we have that capability. What we do, you know, we actually can rent anywhere in the country because we have federal legislation that allows us to do what we do. Because what
great.
Is put over 5 unrelated people in a single family dwelling. But under this law that we have, it allows us to put more people in there, which makes it more affordable for the individuals that live there.
Yeah.
Yep.
So now we're really getting close to the break now.
Yep.
So let me ask you this. How many Oxford houses for women and kids are there in Montgomery County?
Oh, in Montgomery County, we have 3.
3?
Yes.
Are there any vacancies?
Oh, definitely we have some vacancies. It's totally a need. And we're trying to expand because women, that's a special population.
Right.
So we're working on it. But at the moment, we have 3.
Oh, wow, that's great. I thought it was only 1, so that's news to me.
Yeah.
Great, good job.
Yes.
Yeah.
So we're going to take a break right now, and we'll be right back with Mark and Anna on Road to Recovery.
They gave me Vicodin after my knee surgery. I didn't know it would be this addictive. I didn't know how far I'd go to get more.
Opioid dependence can happen after just 5 days. Know the truth, spread the truth.
Welcome back. I'm James Sutton. This is Road to Recovery. My guest today is Anna Mabel Jones and Mark Spence.
Yeah.
And Mark was telling us about his travels with Oxford House in the 80s, right?
Yeah, late 80s, early 90s.
Early 90s,
yes.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
So today, and you took a break and now you're back?
Well, yeah. So I worked for Oxford House from late 1989 to 93, where I traveled around the country to over 30-something states, 80-something cities. So everywhere I would go, I would have to go to AA or NA meetings in any town because nobody ever heard of Oxford House. And basically told them why I was there, find a house for rent, and then start recruiting people to actually live in the house.
So you were the starter. You were the starter.
We had a couple other people, but I was the one they sent kind of everywhere. I went to the Virgin Islands, the state of Washington, you know, Oregon, Detroit, Michigan, Flint, North Carolina, you know, just all over the
Wow, that's a great job.
True pioneer.
Incredible job. to be in early recovery. I had about 1 or 2 years in recovery. And then also we got featured on 60 Minutes back in 1991. Oh, mm-hmm. So I was working in the state of Washington, and they came, a camera crew came out to film me out there opening the houses. Then they flew me back, first class, a crackhead, recovering crackhead, first class, back to this alley where I took my last hit of drugs at.
Get out of here.
Yeah, and we walked through the alley with Meredith Vieira, and it's a beautiful segment we have on 60 Minutes. It was it aired in 1991, wow, where it really talks about our concept, and you know, you can pull it obviously on YouTube and stuff, and on our website, but it's real informational about Oxford House.
Oh, I need to pull that up.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So what's your role today?
My role today is, well, I've done really well. I worked for Oxford, like I said, about 4 years. Then I started doing marketing for a lot of the local hospitals, New Beginnings at Meadows, that was in Crofton, Maryland, PIW, and a couple of other treatment centers. And I came really, really good at it. So I started a business behind it where they were referring to me. So, you know, people were actually coming to me. So I had a contract with different treatment centers to send people to them. So I did that, and also had dual diagnosed houses for a while. And then I was kind of semi-retired, and then I got a call from Oxford House that the concept had exploded. It basically all over the country, and
so everybody would tell you come back to work.
Yeah. Yeah, they were doing really, really well all over the country. And what happened too is the 60 Minute video, they showed at all the houses around the country.
Good.
To educate people. Right. And they's like, who's that guy walking through the alley? Where is he at? Well, he's still clean and still doing this and that. So I came back about 5 years ago. So I'm an alumni. We also have an alumni association. The DMV Alumni Association of Oxford House, because it's a lot of folks.
The DMV too. Yeah. DC,
Maryland, and Virginia.
Oh, it's combined.
Well, this is in Northern Virginia, because a lot of people that go to meetings actually go in Northern Virginia, Alexandria,
true,
Arlington, Montgomery County, DC, PG County. So we just named it for the whole DMV. And we found out that a lot of people with a lot of time in AA and NA actually came through an Oxford House at some point in their recovery.
Okay.
So we're getting a lot of feedback on it. We have a Facebook page. You know, we're getting a lot of positive feedback.
Good.
And we're starting to have events under our alumni association too, you know. So.
Good. Now, let me ask you this. You said co-occurring. So there are Oxford Houses for people that are co-occurring?
Yes,
that's one of the worst areas for support in terms of gaps in services, mental health, people with severe mental health and mental health disorders. There's a real lack of housing for that population. I noticed from the jail, right? We have a lot of people that they get treatment and they have a lot of wraparound services, but there's very little housing. So you guys do have housing for people with co-occurring?
Well, what we consider co-occurring is a person that deals with both. So, yes, definitely they can interview. And we encourage, and of course, people who, a lot of things are happening with the special, you know, the OUD and the opiate use disorder people coming in. So they definitely can interview with an Oxford House as long as, you know, they have, they're dealing with the, because mental and the addictive perception, they go together. So we do have a lot of people coming into Oxford Houses with co-occurring, and they do rather well.
Right.
Oh, good.
Well,
they really
do good. Yeah, excuse me. One of the things is their primary has to be substance abuse.
Okay,
the secondary can be mental illness, and they have to be stable enough to interview at that particular house with their peers. So if you're not taking your medication like you're supposed to, but still going to meetings and you're not completely stable, then you're probably not going to get voted into that particular house. Because you have to cook and clean for yourself and be productive.
You have to be functional.
Yeah.
So it's not a place where we just house and mental health people. No, you have to be fully productive. If you have a mental illness, you have to have a case manager. You need to be on your medications, you know, things of that nature.
So let me ask you this, because you were talking about the opiate-dependent population. Do you have Narcan in your houses? Do you have...
We're making sure that every Oxford House is equipped with Narcan and that each member is trained. And we do that through our chapters. And we also have Oxford House trainings where twice a year the chapters do a workshop and an officer's training. So we're bringing in people to do that particular training. We feel that's really important to have Narcan in every Oxford House. So, yes, definitely.
Okay, good. What about... I know in the Oxford houses, it's peers and it's run by peers. It's, but that's like on a non-professional. Do you hire peers? Do you hire peer specialists? Do you have, because you're just a how many people actually work for Oxford House? Because a lot of your workers are volunteers, or are they paid, or what?
Most of the workers are paid.
Well, they are paid.
They have experience from, normally when you hire, like Mark is an outreach worker, he's lived in an Oxford House, he knows how the system works, so he can go and teach the system to other people in an Oxford House so that that Oxford House can get stable. From that, we start chapters. We have chapters where they're more, it's more of a service position, where they monitor the houses. Yeah, there's a chapter monthly. The presidents of the houses meet at the chapter meeting to discuss issues to expand and, you know, and make sure that we're following the Oxford House policy. Also at that chapter meeting are housing service reps, so they go and check on the houses to make sure they're going strong. So each house has a housing service rep, which is an officer's position in an Oxford House. And from that, we have a regional association. So we have the associations that's going up to the top to make sure everybody's involved in their recovery, everybody's involved in expanding to make sure that the houses are, you know, doing the right thing and running for the Oxford House model.
Okay, so, good.
Yeah.
Well, the reason I was asking is I know we've been in trainings together for recovery coaches and peer specialists.
Oh, yeah.
I was wondering how we can incorporate recovery coaches as a support for the Oxford House system. Mm-hmm. So maybe if a person is having a hard time, and could a recovery coach be assigned to that particular person or that particular region, so that when a person has sort of red flag person looks like they might be close to relapse, we can put a recovery coach with them to support them, to maybe to bring them back engaged, you know?
Oh, that's an excellent idea, or something that I think would be needed. I don't know how we can make that work. I know there are people in Oxford houses who have done the training and who are certified to do recovery coaching.
Okay.
We're trying to get more of our people to go to the trainings because they are offered all over
in the different counties. Right.
So
right.
I encourage that as a resource coordinator. That would be great to have that experience in-house because that's an added push for people, you know, the peers to work together and grow. So,
so we need to talk about that.
Exactly. I'm like, okay, the brains, how can we make that happen?
We got to make that happen.
That's right.
We encourage outside help for individuals that live in the Oxford House. They need help, you know, psychologists, psychiatrists, peer recovery specialists.
Right. Mm-hmm.
We encourage all that. All that's positive.
Yeah.
You know, that's the way they actually can get along better in the house. The more work you do on self, the smoother the house is.
And
remember,
our house, on your recovery, the more work you have, you know, people to help you grow in your recovery. And the peer support thing is so major now, and the workforce is growing in that. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I'm excited. That's the light bulbs are going off.
Good. We're going to get back to that when we're back off the air. Mm-hmm. Now, let me ask you this. What about support in terms of financing? Because I got a lot of people that I work with in the jail. When they leave the jail, they don't really have any money. Mm-hmm. Is there any net or umbrella that can help a person who doesn't have any money when they leave treatment or the jail maybe pay 2 months of their rent? Because the rent is usually around about $500. Is it right?
And it'll vary from house to house.
From house to house.
Because in Oxford houses, you can pay weekly, biweekly, or monthly to help that person who may not want to pay monthly. They may just want to do weekly. And it varies on, you know, the rent to the landlord of how much it'll be. But I'd say you're in the right sum when you say about $500. Mm-hmm. There is help in different counties. Some counties struggle. Some states struggle. I can speak specifically for Montgomery County. I feel it's one of the counties that truly helps a person in need when they need to get housing. I know some of the houses are able to write a letter if someone's accepted for that person to go to the county social services offices
to get help
with their first month's rent to help them get started.
Okay.
And then there are all kind of resources on the boards in Oxford houses to help people get jobs or direct them to those things of that nature. Me, of course, as a resource coordinator now, they have a chance to call me to help them guide them once they're in there.
Okay.
To grow even more in their recovery with the different resources that are offered.
Okay, that's great, so you're a resource broker.
Yeah, that's it. Recovery coach stuff. Yeah. Totally.
Fantastic.
One thing. One thing that's really different, as we know, being in recovery is not unique. People going through things are not unique. So folks know all kinds of resources once they come in, and once they move into a house, somebody has already been through what they're going through.
Right,
so they can direct them to who has monies, who has job opportunities, all that type of stuff. It's supportive, you know, all the way around for that.
Right, that's true. We help each other.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. So we're coming to the end of the show. Is there anything that you want to share with the viewers that you feel is important as a take home? Anything you want to share about the importance of sober housing to your recovery or Oxford Houses in general?
Well, just for me, I can say as a person, as a woman in long-term recovery, just that quote that we hear in the rooms, don't leave before the miracle happens.
Okay.
Give yourself a chance. Oxford House gives you that so that you have a chance to work on you and totally focus on you and what you need to do in your life to grow. It's saving lives, and just stressing that point of you having an 87% chance of staying clean for the rest of your life.
That's big.
Well, I just want to say that Oxford House truly, truly works. You know, we're going into our 45th year now doing this. We've housed and helped over 500,000 people these last 44 years.
Right.
You know, and we're the most successful program of what we are, where the peers run the house themselves. We are so unique, so different, you know, and it's, in our area, it's so much support for you out there to be, you know, to live in the Oxford House. Then you got AA and NA, and then, you know, your other stuff that's going on.
Right.
Yep.
Multiple pathways.
Yeah, multiple pathways.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and that's a wonderful thing about our area, that we have so many different meetings, so many different ways that a person could get support mm-hmm. in their recovery. And Oxford House is definitely one of the pillars in the housing area for sure, because as we learn in recovery coaching, you know, sober housing is what we call recovery capital.
Yes.
Okay.
So if you have family support, you have sober housing, you have professional support, peer support, then probably the numbers like yours, the 87%, you have a good chance of making it.
Yeah.
Yes.
So thanks again for being here. Mm-hmm. This has been James Sutton on Road to Recovery with my good friend Anna Mabel Jones and Mark Spence.
Yes.
And we'll see you next time on Road to Recovery.